Following program has adult language and plenty of spoilers. Listener, be advised.
So Mr. Fix-It likes using adult language. So if you don't like the word fuck, shit, cunt, motherfucker, what are the eight?
No, I don't.
You can't use that?
Search the internet. I don't have the equipment for it right now.
Snowflakes should not apply.
This is the Spawnometer. This is a podcast indexing show where we cover each issue of Spawn and sometimes an additional early image comic, but we have to do it within the span of time of the comic book itself. If the comic book is 22 pages long, we have 22 minutes, which is the case this time. So this week, it's me, Diablo Frank, with the regular co-host.
Let's fix it.
And our special guest.
The Legal Machine.
But he's not that special because he's on most of our other podcasts. How were you first exposed to Erik Larsen?
He did Incredible Hulk work. Did a fill-in issue between McFarlane and Purvey.
And what was your second exposure?
I'm sure it was a cover to something. I'm not sure. I mean, that's the only one that stands out to me, the Erik Larsen cover, because his art style was so different than both of those artists. It was so different than McFarlane and so different than Purvey that it stood out to me.
What about you, Mr. Illegal Machine?
The very first comic book story that I collected from beginning to end was Erik Larsen's Return of the Sinister Six, mm-hmm. which I think was Amazing Spider-Man?
No, I think that was actually... The eponymous Spider-Man series.
Just Spider-Man.
I think it was just Spider-Man. Because McFarlane left with issue, I think, 16. That was when they did the crossover with X-Force. And then McFarlane was retiring from Marvel Comics. Arguably retiring from comics. It hadn't been determined yet. He was just kind of... Because that was pre-image. The image wasn't set yet. And then Erik Larsen took over Spider-Man from him and did that six-part storyline.
When was that? Maybe 1990, maybe?
Yeah, I think that covered a little later than that. Because I think Spider-Man came out in 91. Yeah. So I think Erik Larsen took over Spider-Man from then, and I think he stayed on until near to 25, because I think 25 was one of those hologram covers, maybe. Remember, because you said you collected the hologram covers. Yeah. So I think that's when that happened, and because my brother was still collecting Spider-Man, and I read his copies, and that's, I think I read that whole story arc, because that was the story where he ticked off Peter David because he had Dr. Octopus beat Incredible Hulk, and so David felt the need to have Hulk beat up Dr. Octopus in an issue of Hulk, and then they've been fighting ever since.
1992.
That's the other thing, too. Is, if I remember correctly...
Oh, no, that's the video game. Hold on. Return of the Sinister Six story arc. Dave Michelinie and Erik Larsen. No, it wasn't that late, because I was already here in the H. July 1st, 1990.
Okay.
It was 1990.
Okay. Well, if I remember correctly...
And it was Amazing Spider-Man.
Was it Amazing?
Amazing Spider-Man number 334, et cetera, et cetera.
So you were there when Larsen took over from McFarlane the first time.
Apparently, yes.
Because that was kind of Larsen's career, as he just replaced Todd McFarlane on a Spider-Man book.
Yeah, because I'll never forget the die Dr. Octopus choking Spider-Man cover,
because
I hadn't seen somebody saying die on the cover of a comic book. I think this is all Erik Larsen, right? Erik Larsen and was Dave Michelinie writing it back then?
Yeah, Michelinie stayed on through Mark Bagley, if I remember correctly.
Okay, yeah. So anyway, that's my first that was the first, because those were numbered parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, Return of the Sinister Six, and I don't think I even got them in order, but I did make a point of, as I was buying those, because I probably bought them in 91, so they'd already been out. So I'd go in, I'd save a little bit of money, I'd go buy another issue, I'd save a little money, go buy another issue, and I actually had all six completed.
On the Fire and Water Network, they talk a lot, particularly Shag talks a lot about how everybody has a Batman period. Were you in your Spider-Man period at that point?
I don't think it was a period. I just think that the covers looked cool, and I was very young. Yeah. So I don't think it was a period.
It was just a matter of actually being able to collect something and have the complete set of the complete story.
Based on the cover alone, the beginning and end of the story. Because, you know, usually they don't number the story arcs like that all the time back then.
Right.
You know what I mean? You wouldn't see part one of six or whatever. I could see the beginning and end, and I was like, oh, I can collect six issues and have one story. I'm not in the middle of one story and finishing in the middle of another story. It's complete. So I went and I did it.
Mm-hmm. So, but you presumably read that?
Yeah.
What'd you feel about it?
I have no freaking clue. Yeah, I have no recollection.
Do you have any recollection of the artwork, how you responded to it?
No.
Okay.
Other than the covers. I will not forget those covers. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, Larsen and McFarlane had this interesting parallel career for a while there. Like McFarlane started on Coyote, working for Steve Englehart on his creator-owned book for Epic. Larsen started on creator-owned stuff. And if I recall correctly, that's actually where Savage Dragon made his first appearance, was in one of those small press books.
I just drew the dragon when I was a little kid. I started drawing him when I was in about fourth grade. And I would draw his adventures on 8.5 by 11 paper that was folded in half and stapled up the side. And I did that from like fourth grade up through high school.
Sort of a combination of Batman and Speed Racer and Captain Marvel. And he was a guy who said a magic word and changed from a guy with long blonde hair, which is what I was at the time, a little kid with long blonde hair. And he became this great big superhero guy and flew around and fought crime and all that other stuff. As time went on, every step of the way, I would reinvent him, change him, switch things around, come up with this guy named William Johnson. William Johnson would change into the dragon in times of stress, and he would become bigger and bulkier, and his costume, which was somewhat like this, would become this ratty, horrible thing. And then he would run around and fight crime. After a while, I jumped that. I separated William and Dragon and made Dragon into his own guy. Then at that point, it was no longer a costume that he pulled on, but his actual skin was green, and he had a fin on his head, and he went and he fought crime. Eventually, the dragon was heading up this huge group called the Society of Superheroes.
When I was 19 years old, me and a couple buddies self-published our own comic called Graphic Fantasy, and that was the first time the character was in print as the dragon. He wasn't the Savage Dragon yet. The reason he ended up being called Savage Dragon in the comic was because we got a cease and desist from Dragon Magazine. So we published a couple of issues of this Graphic Fantasy book. I got my character in print, and those stories that I did for that were kind of at the tail end of everything that I had done when I was a little kids, so they were like, that was the capper.
Are you familiar with that material at all?
I'm not sure. Yeah, no. I mean, I remember seeing the pictures of it and stuff because there was a big deal about how, oh, you know, he's not just new to the Image Universe. He's been around before the Image Universe. People are like, what? Like, that's crazy. I thought he was this new character that got invented. And it turns out he had appeared prior.
Erik Larsen's The Dragon debuted in the small press anthology Graphic Fantasy, Volume 1, Number 1, dated June 1982, published by Ajax Comics Group. The issue had a print run of just a couple or 300 copies, most individually signed and numbered by Larsen. Besides the dragon, strips featuring the characters Prism and Ironhawk by other creators were part of the big 72-page issue, which is so rare that when found, it sells for over $1,000. While I definitely go for more than, say, the first appearance of Deadpool, the first Deadpool, there's like hundreds of thousands of copies of that book out there. There's no real shortage. It's a manufactured shortage. I remember literally within the last 5 to 10 years, I could have bought 6 or 7 copies of New Mutants number 98 for $1 a piece, and I didn't. And right. Now those go for quite a bit of money, but it's still a manufactured scarcity. There are a lot more people that want that first appearance of Deadpool, probably more than were reading the comics back then, especially now that he's a multi-million-dollar movie star, but there's still plenty to go around. But literally, there are 200 or 300 copies of the first appearance of Savage Dragon out there. So there's no way of comparing the scarcity.
Mm-hmm.
It could be argued that the dragon introduced in this comic was only a prototype to the Savage Dragon of 1992, as there are considerable differences between the two. Known only as Paul, the original dragon was introduced into comics 10 years after the public was aware of his existence and 8 years into his substantial superhero career. Reflecting the later abandoned influence of artists like Neil Adams, Frank Miller, and Dave Cockrum, Paul Dragon had a leaner, more proportionate body type than the later version, with a tiny head fin more resembling a mohawk and an adorable belt buckle with the letter D on it.
So really the only link is name and sort of look?
See, that's the thing though. Having noted that, there are vastly more similarities between the dragons than differences. Paul is also an amnesiac, having lost 25 years worth of memories before the start of his story. Both characters are blue-collar, outspoken liberal family men who patrol a Kirby-esque landscape of oddball characters. Both dragons' adventures are noticeably more violent and sexually explicit than the norm in their day. Characters bearing roughly the same names, powers, and designs appear in both incarnations. Finally, they're both extremely hairy, green-skinned, two-toed, super-strong, and resilient brawlers who owe more than a little to the likes of Incredible Hulk and Wolverine. The way I see it, Paul Dragon is more like the Bronze Age incarnation of the same character. Not all that much different from the way Wonder Woman's status quo was much altered between 1977 and 1987, but they're still Wonder Woman comics.
That's interesting. I didn't realize that it was that linked. I just knew that he appeared.
The dragon strip began with the titular character having recently retired as the top Midwest regional superhero. While most long underwear types still operate in the New York area, the U.S. government established a superhuman protective agency for the Left Coast called the Complex. 8 years earlier, the Dragon had joined the Society of Superheroes, or SOS, one of the three complexes operating in the U.S. In Chicago, an old mobster who often tangled with the Dragon used a suit of powered armor to become the Bronze Man and murdered the Dragon's wife, Susan Sue Wilson. Deciding to devote his time to his orphan 4-year-old daughter, Angel, the Dragon resigned from the complex. Unfortunately, he had been targeted for revenge by every jumped-up bad guy with a beef for the following 2 months, as well as the robot drones of the escaped Bronze Man, and Angel was gravely injured by one such attempt. Paul Dragon then went on the offensive. This tale ended with a final fatal confrontation against the Bronze Man. Angel recovered and was moved to the relative safety of the complex. This debut appearance featured cameos by characters that would return for the Image Comics series, like the Golden Age-flavored Super Patriot, the Deadly Duo, and more. Paul Dragon was the sole feature of the second and final issue of Graphic Fantasy, which established that the Dragon had a type. He was now dating another buxom blonde, this one named Marcy. Despite the depressed economy and wildly escalating suicide rate, Paul Dragon had kept out of the superhero game, in part because of his new girlfriend. Marcy was the orphan daughter of a patrolman, and swore not to die of a broken heart like her mother did. Eventually, though, we learned that the suicides were tied to the return of Simon Kane, a villain known as the Possessor. Years earlier, one of his bodies had been inadvertently killed by the Dragon, the only hero immune to the Possessor. Kane survived, but his warped mind led him to see this as proof that what the world really needed was a scourge of evil. The Possessor began causing anyone he believed to be evil in any way to kill themselves, clearing the way for a utopia populated only by superheroes. The Dragon stated his horror and disgust over having in any way inspired these mass murders, and the Possessor was guilted into taking his own life. In the end, Marcy accepted Dragon's need to return to active duty to route these sorts of threats.
And from that, I got a job working for a comic book company called Megaton. One of the things I did early on was I brought in the Dragon. And this time, now that he's in real life comic books, I reinvented him again, this time bringing his dead wife back to life and all this other stuff.
Larsen was recruited by writer-publisher Gary Carlson to help launch a different small press anthology with a larger print run, Megaton. Together, they co-created the alien hero Vanguard, with Larsen providing all the art and most of the writing for his 3 appearances in the book. This allowed the cameo inclusion of the Dragon in issue number 2, tasked by President Ronald Reagan himself with capturing Vanguard. The alien was viewed as a menace and an advanced scout for an invasion, with Vanguard's various conflicts with terrestrial agents not helping his image. In truth, Vanguard was stationed on Earth to be a lookout against alien invasion, and despite a language barrier, the Dragon sensed Van's benevolent intent. The pair fought anyway in issue number 3, and despite Paul acknowledging Van's superior strength, Dragon still managed to use skill and cunning to defeat the alien. The Megaton appearances appeared to be either a soft reboot or a prequel to the Graphic Fantasy stories. It's clarified that there are actually 4 complexes, and that these are just mega bases for the national team, the Society of Superheroes. Chicago hosts Complex 3, where Dragon and Angel still live with her mother, the superheroine Smasher. Dragon had to capture Vanguard to get back into President Reagan's good graces, after the scandal of having assigned Mace to guard a controversial religious leader, who Mace himself ended up murdering. Not only does Dragon appear to lead the SOS, but he also trains the next generation of heroes at Complex 3. The core SOS members on site are Mako, Rock, Star, Poison Dart, and Sergeant Marvel, a bizarre Batman lookalike with long serrated ears, who expects to take over the SOS on the day that one of Dragon's dangerous schemes backfires on him. In issue number 4, Dragon concocts a plan to send the trainees on a sort of snipe hunt and have his SOS staff stir up supervillain circles. This would lead to the villains attacking a largely deserted Complex 3, allowing Dragon, Smasher, and Vanguard to hold the fort, rehabilitating the alien's image. The villain turnout was about 10 times larger than expected. In the ensuing battle, Van passed out from blood loss, and the returning young heroes, including a new Mighty Man, were required to actually save the day. Nevertheless, Ronnie Reagan pardoned Vanguard as a result. Larson's art improved by leaps and bounds with each of the Negaton issues. He began heavily employing Zipatone in his final issue, where his character's anatomy and an illusion of weight were finally displayed at a professional level. Larson really went to town on that issue, involving intricate technology and massive crowd battle scenes.
I went on from there to get better paying jobs. I went over and worked for AmeriComics and worked at Eclipse. And then I went from Eclipse to DC and to Marvel.
So basically, Larson's entire life has been devoted to doing these Savage Dragon comics. But when he broke in at DC, just like what happened with McFarlane, he jumped on to a minor league team book. With McFarlane, he did Infinity Incorporated for a number of years. With Larson, he took over Doom Patrol after that book was floundering because they thought it was going to be DC's new X-Men because they had Steve Lytle drawing the book and they made it as X-Men-y as possible. And it didn't work out. And instead, it became this, you know, know, sort of an albatross until...
I always felt Steve Lionel was super underrated.
I love Steve Lionel. I think that he's got a lot of fans, but they're guys who were DC guys from the mid-80s. And so it's
then,
a much
then
more
what was
of a
I
niche.
Seeing Steve Lionel do? Because I'm a Marvel guy, so what was I seeing Steve Lionel do?
No, he did become a Marvel guy eventually. Okay. He did, like, Marvel Comics Presents. He did, like, a number of covers for them, and he did, like, a extended, like, a lot of Typhoid Mary material. I bought the Typhoid Mary trade in part because it collected all of Lionel's material from
Typhoid Mary, I feel, is an underrated villain.
Yes, indeed. I mean, I think when she was created at the time, she was seen as an Elektra ripoff, but I think she's a much more interesting character than that. Larsen didn't have much of a career at DC, just like McFarlane didn't. But then when he goes over to Marvel and he does the same career path as McFarlane by doing Spider-Man books and specifically following him on Spider-Man in a style somewhat similar, that really raised his profile because he replaced one other semi-high-profile artist. I was a big fan of The Punisher, and I didn't notice it at the time, but I suddenly lost interest in The Punisher around the time Will Sportacio stopped drawing the character. And after a few months of fill-ins, the person who replaced him as regular artist on that book was Erik Larsen. It was too cartoony, it wasn't to my taste, so I didn't pay attention to him until the Marvel Universe card series, because he did a lot of the cards, I think for series 2 especially, which I still think is one of the very best superhero trading card sets of all time, was Marvel Universe series 2.
Those the silver border ones or the white border ones?
No, those were the ones that had like the diagonal lines. It was a really well-designed set. Gorgeous, great artwork. A lot of the Image guys and the proto-Image guys like Art Adams contributed to that one. Great looking stuff. But I just never really gravitated much toward Erik Larsen. And then Larsen did that arc in Spider-Man after McFarlane left. And that's actually, I think, what delayed the launch of Savage Dragon, because he was finishing up his Spider-Man arc before he moved over to Image Comics. So he couldn't, even though he was a faster artist than most of the guys, he just couldn't quite get over as quickly as some of the other ones. So Fixit, did you read any of his Spider-Man stuff?
Did he do the Cosmic Spidey?
I think that was McFarlane.
I mean,
because you said you were reading the McFarlane series, so that means you read that. Yeah. And if I remember correctly, I thought it was the Sinister Six, but maybe it wasn't. I remember that they had a bunch of the hot new Marvel characters like Deathlock popping up in that story arc.
I think maybe
Ghost Rider was in that or something.
I remember Ghost Rider.
Yeah, these were great.
Yeah, love Marvel Universe series too.
Oh, yeah.
I had this complete set.
I mean, Jim Lee drew the entirety of X-Men Series 1. I still think Marvel Universe was better. Back when Jim Lee drawing something was like the ultimate to me.
I can't think of what I read of his, because I mean, I really didn't get on board with him until Savage Dragon.
Did you drop Eponymous Spider-Man after McFarlane left then?
I probably stuck to it for a little bit longer, because like, to me, I mean, at the time, the artists I was following were like, you know, Dale Keown, Todd McFarlane, Art Adams, Michael Golden. I always liked that kind of cartoony, bubbly style.
Mm-hmm.
So I was always more drawn to it. Are you sure he didn't do any of the Cosmic Spidey?
Maybe he did, but I really think that was all McFarlane.
I want to say he did an issue where Cosmic Spidey's punching the Sentinel that's like three Sentinels in one.
Like Master Mold or something? Yeah. Or the Tri... No, there was a Tri-Sentinel, right?
Yeah, I always thought it was cool. And there's a cover where he's like punching him. Now, did he ever do any of that, what was it, the Vengeance books?
Oh, like Acts of Vengeance?
Acts of Vengeance, yeah.
Maybe.
I want to say he did some of those.
No, I think he was doing Punisher when that was happening. Because I remember one of the last issues of Punisher I bought was when he went up against Dr. Doom. And they had some unimpressive artist doing that. I think what is that fellow's name? The guy who did the covers for the fake Tales of the Crypt comics that were shown on the actual show where the Crypt Keeper was flipping through his big book of covers. Mike Vosburgh, I think. I think it was Mike Vosburgh was drawing it. And then Erik Larsen took over like right after Acts of Vengeance.
But now Larsen, all he did was draw, right?
I think he did this issue of Acts of Vengeance where he fights Magneto.
Yes. Okay. There you go.
It's Amazing Spider-Man issue.
Yeah. Magneto. So I was right.
So that's okay. Larsen.
Cool. Yeah. Because I remember a buddy of mine, he was huge into that series. He would buy all the Acts of Vengeance. I remember reading them. I don't remember if I liked them, but I remember thinking it was interesting that all the villains swapped heroes, and which would throw them off the game, which I thought was kind of a cool idea. And now, granted, nowadays people would be like, that sounds stupid. But back in that day, I was like,
no, I was a big DC totally ripped off that concept with Underworld Unleashed, and I totally dug that. That was one of like the first things I collected heavily. Because I started with DC Bloodlines and the Titans Hunt before that.
Tri-Sentinel.
Yeah.
I was right. That's the one. Three
and that's
right.
Larsen as well?
Yeah.
Those are the ones.
But is that Cosmic Spidey? Was that when he had the cosmic powers where he was flying and he had the Captain Universe?
I think so.
Had possessed him or something like that?
Don't know.
It was leading up to that. Because I remember he was just beating the shit out of everybody at that time.
Well, that's when he beat up the Hulk and he did that one cover that was an homage to Action Comics number 1.
Yeah.
That's McFarlane.
Yeah, that's McFarlane.
He's showing me the cover where Spidey's punching the Grey Hulk.
This is an Acts of Vengeance 2.
Did they ever collect that?
I don't think they ever collected all of it. They might have done a trade that put some of it in there, but
I'm have to look on Marvel Unlimited.
I want
to
say that maybe
followers of it.
Yeah,
I want to see. I'll reread those and see how they hold up.
I want to say that might have been during that time period when Marvel was doing the ridiculously overpriced trades, where like all their trades cost $25 and $30 yeah, 10 years ago. You know, 15 years mm-hmm. ago. So, yeah.
But those were. But remember, they were on good stock paper.
Sure, sure, but they were still way overpriced. Right. That was when Marvel was still trying to like get out of its bankruptcy, and they just they were charging a real premium. They got away from that, thankfully.
But Larsen didn't write those books, right?
Larsen only wrote the arc that I was talking about from Spider-Man.
Okay.
On the Image timeline, the first book was Youngblood number 1. Mike's Amazing World of Comics says that it came out on April 17th, 1992. No Image Comics came out in May, and then in June, two books came out. Spawn number 1 was on June 3rd, 1992, and Savage Dragon number 1 was a few weeks later, June 24th, 1992. It was the first time two Image Comics shipped in the same month, and no second issues had been released yet. I remember buying Savage Dragon number 1. I don't know if I pre-ordered it. I think I did, because if I remember correctly, the early Image Comics had coupons that you would collect to get Image Comics number 0. And I think I was going for that. And I think I was just such a big supporter of Image that I may have pre-ordered at least Savage Dragon number 1, if not the entire first 3-issue miniseries.
The first issue, is that the one where Savage Dragon is like in a running position?
Yeah, where he's like kind of...
it's kind of a pinkish
running
cover.
Leapy... orange. Oranges and yellows.
Orange, okay. I thought...
I dig the cover. And I think it's a nice action shot.
I disagree. It's all action. It's just an action shot.
Yeah, but I think it's an iconic image, though. I think that they've homaged this cover a number of times, mm-hmm. and I always go, oh, yeah, that's the Savage Dragon cover whenever they try to do a riff on it.
Didn't they do multiple colorings of this cover?
They might have.
I remember one with a pink background, with a yellow logo, and for some reason, a pink background. I don't know why. Because I remember going to a shop one time, and they had, like, number one, but multiple different colors, because everybody's like, oh, which color are you in? And I was like,
I wouldn't have remembered it unless you mentioned it, but it does sound familiar now that you do. I mean, Youngblood had the second printing, so maybe they did the same thing with Savage Dragon. Or maybe they had like a... A lot of these got packaged into like Walmarts and shit, right?
Yeah,
and
they were everywhere. Dude.
Yeah, so I think
Walgreens, like everywhere I went, they had them.
I love the cover of Savage Dragon number 1, just like I love the cover of Youngblood. Not as much, just because I enjoy... For starters, because they're too similar. Because they both have those multicolored sunbeams, and they're both very California. They're both making you very aware that this is not a comic book that's going to take place in New York City, like every fucking Marvel comic.
No,
and
Chicago.
Really, well, no, I know, but okay, you're right. You got me there. It does take place in Chicago.
It sounds like New York City.
No, it's not just like New York City. I mean, because they make a big point.
Large metropolitan city with lots and lots of buildings and fire hydrants and cars. So, yeah.
Okay, you got a point. You got me on that one. In comic
book terms, did I just Frank?
You got me on that one. I'll on that. In comic book terms, there's not a lot differentiating the two cities as portrayed in the comics. Because, as you said, they're both just cities. They're not showing you anything in this version of Chicago that you immediately go, oh, that's Chicago.
Oh, sure. And I actually appreciated that, because it's that whole Marvel concept of we're grounded in your reality type thing, where they actually said it's Chicago, Chicago PD.
Yeah.
So I was kind of like, okay, cool. They're doing the Marvel thing.
Well, it's cool too, because he's the only guy in Chicago too.
Well, at the time too, well, he was really the only superhero, right? Because they kind of hint that Youngbloods are making appearances, but they're not.
Stop. It's Youngblood. It's not plural. Please stop it.
Youngbloods.
Well,
I just listened to the episode earlier today, and you were fucking saying Youngbloods over. It has never been Youngbloods ever.
Well, it's not Brian Gosling either, but...
It's the Brian Gosling.
Because, I mean, I thought it was a little indulgent for us to, like, have our second...
Or Alimantium.
Fuck you, asshole.
10 years passes. A group of us all at Marvel Comics, all at the same time. We're all going to form our own company, Image Comics. And so what do I dredge up? The dragon. This time, I had to get it right the first time. And what I did was, I decided to make him a cop. And I thought, well, this would be a smaller starting place, and then eventually I could have other superheroes join with the police, and eventually they would outgrow being part of the police force, and they could become the Society of Superheroes, and I'd be back where I was 15 years ago. Now that he is a cop, I'm happy with that, I'm comfortable with that, and I'm kind of striking off in my own direction, and this ends up being an entirely new character, whether I... eventually introduce the woman who was his wife, or give him a kid, or whatever. I'm not even sure at this point. I've got some long-range plans. I have a fair idea of where I'm going, but usually it's in the neighborhood of 5 or 6 issues in the future, not 5 or 6 years. But we'll see.
And when I started doing Savage Dragon Image Comics, my goal was to work my way towards those two stories that I had done already as a kid, so that basically I started one place and I got there. I'm going to start a different place and get to that same location. And then at that point, I could do whatever the hell I wanted to, but I felt like I needed to get to that. That was my goal. And that goal was like issue 63, so I'm considerably beyond that at this point. My house ended up burning up in 1991, and all the comics I drew as a little kid were gone. I don't have anything back when he used to have a cape and gloves and stuff like that. He was originally actually a ripoff of Batman. If you can imagine, there was a little mask hole that was there, and then he had a green mask and a green cape and flesh-colored the... Eventually, I just got tired of drawing the cape and all that other nonsense, so I was like, all right, I'm just going to make it that it's part of the dude.
And I also like the little front piece on the inside front cover, you know, giving another nice action shot of old Savage Dragon.
Is that the Malibu logo down there?
Yep. There's an Image logo on the cover. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the inside front cover does have the Malibu comics. So yeah, let you know.
I had that issue. I remember reading it.
Yeah. Did you buy the three-ish miniseries off the stand?
Yes. Well, Savage Dragon, I remember I had a weird relationship with Savage Dragon. I bought them, but I didn't read them right away. I was reading Spawn. I was reading X-Men.
Yeah, well, you said that you did the same thing with Spawn. You kept collecting waiting to read them.
I would read pretty quick. I'd collect maybe two issues and then read them. I've always had a strange tendency. I couldn't just read one floppy. I had to read two or three floppies back to back. I don't like just one episode. I have to have two or three episodes. So I think with Savage Dragon, I would collect like five and then read them all. Like almost a mini trade and then read it.
Well, in the case of Savage Dragon, that would be because it was only a three issue miniseries.
Well, I remember.
So did you wait until the ongoing started before you started reading?
No. Which one's the one where he's found in a circle of flames?
That's the very first issue.
Okay. So I remember reading that.
Mac, did you buy Savage Dragon when it was coming out?
I might have bought issue one.
And you didn't get any further than number one?
No.
What do you remember from issue number one?
I think I was just collecting the number ones.
Okay.
I remember him naked with the fire all around.
Anything else?
Not really. Just a lot of questions at the end of the first issue.
Does the Savage Dragon mean anything to you?
So the Savage Dragon is easily the most, I don't know if respect is the right word, might be the right word, that to me, I don't feel like the Savage Dragon ever sold out. And maybe if he would have had an opportunity to sell out, he would have sold it out. But I feel like there is a intrinsic, artistic, independent feel to the Savage Dragon. I feel like you will have to kill Erik Larsen to get him to stop drawing Savage Dragon. And it's kind of the same with, maybe not exactly the same with Spawn, but like, I don't know, there's something, Spawn's a little different. I don't know if it's because Spawn got so popular and kind of transcended independent comic books whenever there's cartoons and movies and shit like that. There's just something different about Savage Dragon, mm-hmm. for better or for worse. I don't know.
There's a greater commitment. There's a greater singular creative vision. And you just can't fault that Larsen has sat down and drawn 220 some odd issues of this book continuously, month after month after month. He gets it done. All these guys are married to their characters. All these guys have love for their characters. But he just takes it to another level. He's the guy who is married to the same woman for 60 freaking years. And they die once apart, that kind of thing.
So to me, it's like Cal Ripken Jr.'s record in baseball. Strap in, Frank, I'm talking sports. He played in 2,632 consecutive baseball games. That's ridiculous. Step back and go, holy shit. The dude played a competitive professional sport where there are projectiles being hurled at you 2,632 times without missing a day or getting sick or having diarrhea or eating a bad hot dog is freak jaw-dropping.
That's an accomplishment that will probably never be seen again.
The accomplishment, which is why it took 2,632 to be like, holy shit, that is freaking impressive. To me, Savage Dragon is kind of like the Cal Ripken Jr. record. Is it the most amazing comic book? Some days, does he not have as much time as he probably would have liked to get the issue out, and he just has to get the issue out because he has to get another issue out? Yeah, probably. But taken as a body of work, that is unbelievably impressive.
I think that if you stack it issue to issue against pretty much anything else Image has come out with, I do think that it's probably the best book issue by issue for the length of time that it's come out. You may have had stronger series that ended much sooner, but I think that in terms of raw enjoyment and in terms of the people who love Savage Dragon, man, they've stuck with that book for 25 years now. And I don't think you get that level of commitment just for nothing. I don't know if there's anybody who better epitomizes the ideals behind what Image was founded to do, with the possible exception of Robert Kirkman, than Erik Larsen. And in fact, you know, Larsen writes and draws his own book. He didn't farm that stuff out. There's no creators who are pissed off at him because they got cut out somewhere along the line while he was farming the stuff out to other media. So I do think that probably he is the exemplar of the ideal of what Image was founded to become.
Yeah, for sure. I totally buy into that.
And what's interesting about reading those early stories too is, especially the early stuff, I realized, I don't know if you ever did this, but when I was in my teens, I got a word processor. And as a teenager, unless I'm going to go work at the school paper or something, there's really nothing to do with a word processor. And the fact is, I never stayed at any school long enough to get invested enough to be a part of any of their extracurricular stuff. So what I would do with my word processor is I would take all the stories I came up with when I was playing with my action figures up to that point in the 10 years, whatever, that I'd been playing with toys, and try to take those and turn them into comic book stories in a continuity that dated back to the 1960s. And I'd type up these little synopses of all the little stories I'd played out with my action figures. And I still have those in a box somewhere where, you know, I took advertising art and altered it so it would look like the 60s version of this character and all this kind of stuff. This is huge, convoluted history that I did for my own entertainment. And of course, everybody hopes one day they're going to become a pro and actually get to take all those childhood fantasies and turn them into comic books. I think what happens though is once you're a creator, you start living your new fantasies. You start creating the new thing that you're dreaming up as an adult, because you recognize that the stuff you enjoyed as a kid, especially when it goes back 10, 15 years, isn't necessarily relevant to what's going on in comics today. And I think that happened with Erik Larsen when he did Savage Dragon. He'd already been a pro and he knew what he had to cut and what he had to alter to make it a property that people could jump onto and would be welcoming and wouldn't just barrage them with continuity. But I think if you look at those early Dragon stories, they're so dense and there's so many ridiculous elements there that are the kind of thing that you wouldn't include in a comic unless there's something like Axe Cop, where you're selling it as the creation of a six-year-old being interpreted by their older brother and stuff. You would just cut that today, but there's a raw id there. There's a raw childhood wonder to those early stories that I both admire and also I'm kind of like, but you don't want to do that. You know, as a professional, as somebody who's trying to sell their wares to other people, that's not what you want to do, but you have to admire that this is the guy, the one guy I can think of in comics that took all those childhood phantasmagoras and turned them into an actual product that you could read, that you could share with other human beings. He took all those comics that he'd been drawing since he was a little kid and he turned it into something he could actually give to somebody else and have them just sort of like lather in his childhood fantasies. And so that's admirable, and it's hard not to get caught up in his enthusiasm for his world within those stories. It actually makes me appreciate what he did in adapting that continuity into something that was at a professional caliber, that was something that you could actually treat as professional comics as opposed to fan craft, which is what those earlier stories were, because I could see how he had to level those characters up and turn it into something that was contemporary, that worked in their times. So even though I'm kind of critical of that miniseries when I read it and we talk about it later on in the show, after having gone back and looked at those early stories, I actually have a greater admiration for them now, realizing how far he had come as a creator and how well he was able to adapt all that stuff into something that actually works.
Yeah, and another thing I'll say for Erik Larsen too is that he seems like the same dude too. I feel like he's the same guy that he was back in the mid-90s. Like when I see him interacting with people on Twitter and stuff nowadays, he doesn't seem like he's some big-headed. He just seems like he's like the same guy. I don't know what it is. Where I feel like Todd McFarlane is up in some castle somewhere away from the masses, you know, and he doesn't want to sully himself. Where I feel like Erik Larsen's just a fucking dude.
There's an Ani DiFranco song that I'm really fond of where she's talking about how, especially at parts in her career where she looked like she could maybe break out and become a bigger star than she was. She had her loyal fan base. She's a chick with a guitar. She knows her audience. She knows the kind of things that she wants to convey, her life stories and emotions and stuff. But there are always people coming up to her telling her how she could really break out and become a big star. And the song is basically saying, everybody's a fucking Napoleon. Everybody's got to be a fucking world conqueror. And why don't you just find the thing that you love to do, that other people love you doing, and just do that instead of trying to conquer the whole goddamn world. And I think that a lot of the guys, they all want to be not just creators, not just happy in their craft and happy with the people that appreciate what they want to do. They want to create that thing that's going to become a movie, and it's going to be a TV show and a video game, and I'm going to be a big star and make $1 million. You know, he was the one image creator founder at Heroes Con. I regret that I didn't get any interviews. I didn't talk to nearly as many people as I wanted to. I didn't get nearly as many commissions I wanted to, but I walked out of that pilot past that guy repeatedly, and he was just sitting there at his table drawing his stuff, smile on his face, just looks like he's happy and just loving being there and loving being amongst his people. And you're absolutely right, you appreciate that. That's refreshing.
Yeah.
First thing I want to do is catch up on some notes that I didn't get to cover on previous episodes because we talked a whole bunch about our experiences with Todd McFarlane. Number one, what do we think of the Spawn logo?
I think it's good.
Very Spider-Man.
I like the Spawn logo. I don't think it's too for Spider-Man. It's much pointier. No. It's the logo.
Oh, the logo. Oh.
See, I hate when people do that. And no offense to you, but people will always say that a symbol is a logo and vice versa. A logo is letters. So, but would like if I try to find a logo on the internet, they always do that kind of shit.
I think the skull for a nasal lamp. The skull.
I like the skull, but the problem with the skull is it's the Punisher skull with the cheekbones removed and the lower jaw removed.
Correct. That's the Punisher skull.
On the other hand, look at the back where they you see the Spawn symbol, the Spawn icon. Fucking Deadpool stole that shit.
Yeah, okay. Other than
Spider-Man. I don't know.
That looks very Spider-Man.
There's elements of Spider-Man, but I don't think it's entirely Spider-Man. It's got the little diamond in it and shit.
It's totally Spider-Man. Let me tell you why. It's the character's head transformed into a circular logo. That's 100% Spider-Man.
Okay, you may have a point in that.
Because it's literally the character's head with eyes.
Didn't Kirkman do a Spawn ripoff that's a Spider-Man?
Haunt. Where he was throwing jizz instead of web, which kind of ruins the joke.
He looked like Spawn and had Spider-Man's powers.
The covers of the early Spawns had airbrush coloring by Ken Stacy. I thought that was pretty sweet, especially on that first cover, those hues of purple. I want to give a shout out to Ken Stacy. He only did the first two covers. The first issue was dedicated to Jack Kirby. Do you think that Kirby would want Spawn dedicated to him?
No. I think he would have taken it as an insult.
What do you think?
I think that if Todd said, this is a shot at Stan Lee and Marvel Comics, that's why we're dedicating it to you, then I think that he would actually be okay with it.
Yeah. No, I think so, too. I think that Jack Kirby had so much anger about what Marvel did to him and how they ripped him off and how they made him all these promises they didn't keep. And DC did the same shit because the Carmine Infantino made him a bunch of promises when he went over to DC and they fucked him on that deal, too. So I think that Jack Kirby would have been proud of what the Image guys could accomplish.
I think Jack would have said, this character is too similar to one of my creations.
I don't think I think he's possessive like that.
Spirit of the tribute, he would be down with it. Whether or not he'd give a shit about the book, he probably would hate it.
No telling. It's funny to me because parts of the first was Spawn is set 5 years ago in 1987. That just kind of fucks with my head at this point because it's been so many years beyond. What's interesting, if you read the Spawn number one, it's an alternate universe because in that universe, Al Simmons is present to stop John Hinckley Jr. from assassinating or attempting to assassinate Ronald Reagan in 1981, which shows how long Al Simmons' career was. He was also Marine Lieutenant Colonel, so he's pretty damn high ranking. Yeah. So this guy was probably an older guy, you would think, and he probably had an involved career. I'm surprised we've never gone back and really looked that much into Al Simmons' career before he died.
They touched on that in later issues, didn't they?
Not that much, I don't think. When he died, a lot of his money went to the United Negro College Fund, which I thought was interesting. And Al Simmons was so famous by the time he died that he was one of People Magazine's 10 Sexiest Men of 1985.
What?
Al Simmons,
What?
There's this dude named Martin Alexander who introduced Wanda Blake to Al Simmons at the 1984 Republican Convention. Now, presumably, Al Simmons was there because he saved Ronald Reagan, but that means that probably Wanda Blake was a Republican, and quite probably Al Simmons was too.
Sure.
Was that something you were expecting when you thought would think about Spawn?
And see, well, but he was very military career.
I don't think the Republican Party was as whitewashed in the mid-1980s.
I'm not sure. Well, maybe, yeah. They were still in that transition where the Democrats and the Republicans had kind of flipped who was doing what. I like that they have ties between Spawn and Youngblood very early on. I wish that Image was able to maintain their universe. I wish they were able to continue to be a collective that all worked together instead of burning each other or ignoring each other after a while.
Well, the problems with it, they were all below all their deadlines, so you couldn't do that.
No. I'm talking about they don't reference each other's books anymore in part because of the infighting that happened among the Image creators because it screwed stuff up as far as rights issues and stuff go. Spawn is like ground zero of how messed up the rights issues got for all those characters related to those books. Because Spawn was kind of, I think one of the reasons why Spawn...
Wait, so you're saying you liked that they tried to intertwine them? Or
I liked it, but I also understand why they don't do it, because Spawn got fucked by that, which we'll see later on in the series. I like that Al Simmons is shown with one of those stupid Rob Liefeld rifles where it makes no sense and it's got rabbit ear aerials coming off of it and stuff. It shows that he obviously had ties to Youngblood because he had their dumb Liefeld guns. There's a lot of skulls in the early issues of Spawn, and I can't tell whether there's a strong Jim Starlin influence on those issues or if Todd McFarlane was just really into metal. But I noticed that Starlin and McFarlane had a lot of similar iconography, especially in those early issues, with all the skulls and shit that you'd see in, like, Captain Marvel and Warlock, especially.
You want me to hit Todd up on Twitter real quick?
No. What do we think of Spawn's original costume?
Doctor Strange's cape with Spider-Man's costume.
And the hip pouch. Why did he have the hip pouch?
Well, he had the chains, which was a little different than Doctor Strange.
Ghost Rider.
Ghost Rider. The color scheme was kind of spidery.
Yeah, well, it's black and red. That's the easiest, cool, badass color scheme to pull off. If you want a guy to be the official badass, you give him black and red. Remember, even fucking Namor had black and red during Atlantis attacks. But what do we think about the pouches? And he's got the band on the one arm, and then the pouch, and he's asymmetrical.
Very late, you?
The pouches are.
I guess that was supposed to be his link to Youngblood.
I don't know if it's Liefeld as much as it's just period.
Oh, true.
I think Liefeld took it and ran with it.
Speaking of Liefeld, looking through these early Spawn issues, I noticed that Todd McFarlane draws shitty feet. He will draw feet, which sets him apart from Liefeld, but his feet are garbage. They're just little triangles.
Who draws good feet? Riddle me this.
Stranko did pretty good feet. Stranko. He gave you those nice big... I think Herb Trempe did some pretty good feet. Anybody who was a classic Hulk artist, Dale Keown did some damn fine feet.
Oh, hell yeah.
Keown did do some nice... Gary Frank also.
I'm not a foot man, but I'm just saying. Nobody ever seems to call Tom McFarlane out on this, but not only does he do the bullshit triangle feet, but he has this nasty tendency. He'll take somebody from the waist down and just throw a bunch of cross-hatching on top of it. And it's just an abstract shape. Not as bad as McFarlane seemed to, though.
Man, I think that, and I told you, Rob Liefeld said that he was influenced heavily by Mike Mignola, and Mike Mignola did that shit all the time. He goes, go count the feet in Mike Mignola's count.
Much.
You're not going to see him. It's going to go into shadows halfway down their body.
And I know Mr. Fix loves Mike Mignola, but that's a dude who takes a lot of fucking shortcuts too. That dude has definitely figured out how to.
I like his art style, but you got to remember, dude, they're on deadlines, and their style is not very basic. So of course they're going to find as many shortcuts as they can. Not drawing feet, easy shortcuts. Basic backgrounds, they're not Art Adams, who's going to go in there detail and fucking you'll be able to see like telephone wires in the back, and you can actually see the Ma Bell symbol. They're not that detailed. I forgive him for it.
We didn't mention because we didn't have the original Spawn comics, but the Spawn number one had a pinup of P-I-T-T.
Pitt.
Pitt. So, but back then he was an acronym for some reason.
What did it stand for?
P-I-T-T. Well, they never revealed it because when it finally came out as an image title, it was...
Insurance.
Testosterone technician. Testicular testosterone.
Yes. Spawn number two, dedicated to Steve Ditko. Thoughts?
What?
Because he's another guy who got...
shot at Stanley?
I think so, yeah. Part, which is funny because they were friendly with Stanley, too.
Did
they
get along with Stanley?
They made those videos together at Staber Entertainment.
Yeah, so why would he be taking shots at Stanley?
I think it's about...
the establishment and they're taking their shots.
Well, no, they're not explicitly saying anything about Stan Lee, and they were all... the image artists were all antagonistic toward the writers anyway.
So I'm going
to say... I think it's about how the artists...
give up his hat to the artist.
I think what it is, these are artists that co-created or did the lion's share of the creation of characters that they never got the proper credit for and no money and no copyrights.
Right, but who does get the money? Who has copyrights?
The companies, usually.
And Stan.
Stan doesn't really get any money. No, but he's a figurehead, though.
Just like we always joke that Stanley's name's on fucking everything.
Yeah, we did definitely claim more credit than he deserved.
Excelsior, exactly.
Okay, another part of the Image universe, in Spawn number two, we get mentions of the dragon and how he's in Chicago. And it was just nice to kind of see that happening. They mentioned that Wanda Blake used money from Al's Memorial Fund to open her third care clinic for disabled children.
Yeah.
So they really were going for sainthood with Wanda Blake. I think it was interesting that Sam and Twitch were surprised that there was such a thing as non-rich famous superhero types. And they were still using Youngblood as shorthand for all superheroes in the Image group at that point in time. So I did dig that. Issue number two is where we actually find out Jason Wynn is the guy that he sees as his main enemy. He talks about how he realizes that was his former boss. They met through President Reagan, and at one time they were like brothers, but liberties were taken, innocents were harmed, and it ruined their friendship. And it basically puts Wynn in the headlights. It's like, oh, this is probably the guy who killed Al Simmons. And finally, Spawn number two is the issue where the clown explained the very basic idea of what a Hellspawn was. But now we're on to issue number three, which was dedicated to Jerry Robinson. Which, thoughts on that?
Cool Gardens Yahtzee.
Jerry Robinson was one of the main artists on Batman when it was credited to Bob Kane. He's supposed to be the co-creator of the Joker with Bill Finger, and I think he was also supposed to help create Robin. So another guy who
just continues the theme.
Yeah, well, and also you're like, who's Jerry Robinson? So that shows that that guy didn't get enough attention.
So Bob Kane did not create Joker?
Bob Kane didn't create, he didn't even really create Batman for the most part. If you look at his early designs, Batman was going to be like red. So screw Bob Kane. That guy's a son of a bitch.
But yeah, I want to say everybody in the comic.
Oh yeah.
He was like a total company man, right? And every time
he fucked DC too.
Did he really?
Oh yeah, he fucked DC too. And he fucked his fellow creators. He fucked Siegel and Schuster. He would just fuck anybody.
I think that was one of your podcasts. I read that, right? Or I heard that where
might have been.
He was DC's witness against Simon and Schuster.
Right. So he's a son of a bitch. So Spawn number three is the first issue where we actually learn that Wanda is the wife that Spawn sold his soul to come back to. And this is Wanda Blake, who's been mentioned a bunch of times, but they never actually made it clear that Wanda Blake was Spawn's wife. Do you want to give the synopsis?
Spawn is now starting to have memories they're starting to flood in, and he's starting to remember things of his life. He's remembering Wanda, he's remembering Wynn, he's remembering he was a soldier, and he decides to go find these files. There's supposed to be some files that the government was keeping, so he's going to use those files to kind of fill in the blanks in what he can't remember. So we're introduced to Malbolgia, who is now in the background. Spawn is talking on the ship while apparently Malbolgia can hear him from the underworld.
Well, and they still haven't named him Malbolgia, right? He's just a generic tan demon dude.
Well,
not generic. He's a pretty distinctive demon dude, but...
Yeah. And he's basically...
Is he gray? I thought he was like taupe or something.
And he makes mention that the reason Simmons was picked was because of the past, his past as a soldier. And so you can't go from being a killer to trying to become a saint, and that he's going to make his life a living hell, and that he's there for a purpose, and he's soon going to learn his purpose. In this issue, we get a lot of background on everybody else. Sam and Twitch pop up. They're discussing about all the mafia murders, all the mafia hitmen that are having their hearts removed. They're trying to figure this out. Spawn is talking shit. He's looking for file. He goes to a building. There's a gentleman who's hitting on his secretary, trying to get her pants. Spawn picks him up, threatens him, I guess hurt him or kill him or do something to him. At this point, Spawn breaks into the office, finds the files, and starts reading up on Wanda, everything that's going on around him, and finds out that...
He made a point of mentioning, too, that he was one of these guys who didn't like how invasive the agency he worked for was, and now he's using those options to find out about Wanda.
Yeah, to invade her privacy. He freaks out when he realizes that there's some important information in the file. He then decides to go try to see Wanda. He decides to use his power, and of course, like we discussed in the last issue, every time he uses power, he's a white man with blonde hair, very surfer dude, decides to go visit Wanda at her home, finds out she's, I believe, in a wedding dress?
Yeah, she was in a gown to go to, like, a ball or something, because she keeps using this money that from Al Simmons' death fund to help the underprivileged, and this is another instance of her doing that.
And so as they're sitting there talking, he's kind of, getting a little teary-eyed, they're talking, he's there to make sure her dog is registered or some bullshit like that.
Well, that's his claim.
Yeah, basically, his excuse to get
And that was his dog, apparently, and she kept the dog out these years. Okay, so
all of a sudden, a little girl comes running up to her mother. Turns out to be Wanda's daughter, who's, I believe, only 19 months old.
Cyan,
Cyan. Well, I don't think they said the name yet.
That kid is walking, talking something fierce for that young, though, I think.
As they're talking, he's talking about the little girl. He starts freaking out a little bit because she has this young daughter. He's married. And finds out that she married his best friend, Terry, right?
Yes. Terry Fitzgerald was one of his best friends and hooked up with her afterwards because they were both, like, consoling each other over the loss of their loved one.
And so he passes out.
And, of course, the big thing, too, is that Al could never give her that baby. Took Sari. It was always Al's fault. He was the one who was infertile and kept her from getting impregnated.
Spawn passes out. When he's coming to, there's Terry, there's Wanda, there's their daughter. He's just trying to get out of there as quick as possible by this point.
By the way, I'm looking. Cyan was 15 months old.
Simmons is pissed that all he wanted was his wife. He converts back to Spawn. He starts screaming about the deal, how he's going to make them pay, because all he really wanted was his wife.
Yeah, I think this is where they made it explicit, too, that they made the deal with the devil to get Wanda back, and now he doesn't have Wanda.
And basically everything he tried to do, the devil has corrupted it in every way. From changing to using the power to look normal, to sending him to a time whenever Wanda's already moved on.
Because he doesn't want to invade her happiness. Yeah. He's like, oh, she's happy. I'm going to fuck this up if I'm not careful. So
basically, it starts showing that he's kind of selfish now. Like, if he's going to do it, he's going to be selfish about taking away her happiness. At this point, that's when the Violator shows up, letting him know, hey, I'm here to wreck your shit. You got to get with the program. Did we agree the clown is called the Violator as well?
We've established that they are one and the same.
He turns into his demon form, plucks Spawn's heart out of his chest. He almost seems like he's jealous of the Spawns because they get so much attention. He's a little pissed off, starts to walk away, thinking that he won and he's the Violator. And Spawn stands up and says, who says I was human? And he has a big gaping hole in his chest with that green energy spilling.
This is the first issue, I believe, where they mention Grandma Blake, who's going to become a major member. They also mention that Spawn wants to check on his brothers and his mom and dad, who are apparently as far as he knows, all still alive. He finds it interesting that he himself was a fairly religious person who's stuck in a literal biblical nightmare between heaven and hell. The devil himself is amused that here Al Simmons was his hired killer who claims all these morals, but he's going to enforce Al Simmons' role, his intended role, in expanding Hell's Army.
Yeah.
So that kind of makes that clear. Sam and Twitch are trying to find out what's going on with the Violator case, but they're cock-blocked because the mayor actually likes that all these hitmen are getting killed, so he doesn't care about that case getting wrapped. Spawn chokes out that CIA sexual harasser guy named Billy over unpaid child support, and that's what helps lead him to Wanda. It is nice that they're finding ways to give Al a morality, even though they also established that there's a reason why he went to hell in the first place. They do mention that Wanda moved away from Al's parents in Staten Island for Queens to live with her husband. Or I don't know if it was her parents or his parents that she moved away from. Her parents. So she's from Staten Island. Yeah. That's all I got. We're good. All
right.
Any comments on this issue? Was it worth the shit?
It's building up. We're not there. We're going to see. I'm sure the big reveal and everything's coming next. Maybe two issues.
Did they saw the Spawnometer in this too?
Yes.
When did they drop that?
Not fairly early on. Once it was clear that the book was going to make money and last a while, they stopped bringing it up. But this one ends at 8821, as I recall.
And that was Spawn Talk.
Is it called Spawn Talk?
No, I'm saying this to the Spawnometer. He was trying to insist that Spawn Talk, but no. Spawnometer.
And we're still not sure whether it's based off of time or energy base. Well, you said energy base because you read that.
I was going to try to get into an interview, but we had too much to cover, so next time.
Okay, so we got some Facebook loving from Siskoid, Ryan Daly, Michael Wagner, Michelle Fife, and for the non-discerning reader, we got some Twitter loving from 20th Street Geek, The 108th Sage, A Beardo Talks Film, Ange, Between the Pages, Brooding Muse, Brian in Bottles, Camilla Hayes, Cash Flag, Chris Sheehan, Coffee and Comics, Comics Tweets, Ed Moore at Any Comics Fan, Marvel Bronze Age, Miskatonic, and Till Productions, Eli, Inigo Montoya, Eric Mannix, Glenn Walker, Geek Yogurt Podcast, Gold Mine LLC, Good Friends Bad Movies, Good Times Great Movies, Grant Richter, The Hammer Strikes, Jeffrey Brown, Joe Crawford, Just in Time Podcast, Justice First Dawn, Katya Robinson, Knowing Flame Comics, Lava Hog, Longbox Crusade, Mikey Flash, Odell Abner Dracula, The Pod Couple, The Quipster Podcast, Randy Caldwell, Raven X Fields, Real Comic Heroes, Ryan Daly, Sean Merrick, Silver and Gold Podcast Network, Siskoid, Talk Nerdy to Me, Tamsin McDonough, and Trekker Talk. Scott Rowland tweeted, first ep was good listening. Looking forward to this one.
Michael Wagner, great episode. Looking forward to your words on Jim Lee.
Silver and Gold Podcast wrote, "You're my hero, Frank."
Randy Caldwell, "Rob Layfield is cool. I once saw him crawl under a table to go to a young fan and take a photo with him before signing my comic. Of course, the comic book he signed was Captain America number one after the Onslaught Assault storyline. That's great. I like Rob Layfield for the reason. On the other hand, there is stuff to contend with."
And he gives a link to a bunch of his X-Force art and things that were bad about that artwork. We got love for Liefeld, so. Ange said, "Listening, but just have nothing to add. I was never a McFarlane guy. I wasn't a Spawn guy outside of the Gaiman Moore Sim run coming up. So I will be listening to hear about what I missed, although I don't know if I missed anything."
Siskoid said, "Not clear if putting a timer on the discussion is a genius or terrible idea. Time will tell."
I see what you did there.
What do you mean?
He said time will tell when he's talking about time.
So the game is, Fisk tries to finish his thoughts on the issue while Frank runs out the clock with various detours. That'll do. Malibu didn't get the Imageverse, so they did both Ultraverse and the Centaur Gold Age Heroes Revival. Man, there were a lot of new universes popping up at this time. Yeah, there were. Weren't there? Impact, Valiant, Razor's Edge. Oh, yeah, there was tons of them.
You remember Razor's Edge? That was Clive Barker's universe that Marvel...
Oh, yeah, yeah. I thought that was under Marvel. Because I think it was called
the Razor Line. It was an imprint of Marvel.
The Hellraiser comics.
But I think you might have owned part of that or something. Or it was a universe anyway.
Well, they did like 7 or 8 issues of Hellraiser comics under the Marvel banner, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, but I think the Razor Line was like Ecto Kid, which the Wachowskis wrote, Steve Scroggie drew.
I didn't see any of
that. Saint Sinner. There were other ones. That was the only two I can remember.
I was really big on Valiant. That was my second or third choice.
Secret Transmission wrote, "So the Spawnometer podcast was good. I've only read 1 through 100, then like 180 through 225. I like the meter thing. Super clever. Kudos. Listening to episodes 1 and 2, you guys blew me away with lots of history. Good stuff. Honestly, I never read any of the other Image titles, so that'll be cool to see what Spawn did in other books. Keep it up."
Cool. And nice.
Secret Transmission actually was wondering if there had been a Spawn podcast in existence. He like Googled it or ran it through Twitter, found ours, was like, "If there's not a Spawn podcast, I want to start one." And then he starts like, "I like yours."
A lot of work, trust me.
Yeah, but it's pretty cool. I really enjoy doing the Spawnometer. I enjoy talking about all the Image stuff.
I like reading some of the old stuff. I went back and I started reading Savage Dragon, Cyberforce. I just read for some reason.
Really? Okay, now where are you at on Cyberforce?
Issue 3.
Issue 3 of the miniseries?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe we'll record Cyberforce next.
And then I started reading
Wetworks.
Well, because I have a long box just full of all Image. So I was just kind of going through there. And some of the stuff, like I'll have like 2 issues, 3 issues. Like I had Velocity 1 and 2.
Do you have any any Shadowhawk?
I have Shadowhawk like one or two. I think I actually have the trade that has the first issues. Okay. Where he's going around breaking people's backs.
Because I think Shadowhawk is the next one we're supposed to do.
I'll find my... I believe I have the trade to the first one.
Well, if you're that's already reading one, the Cyberforce
cover
mini...
Where it's a black cover and you open it and it's a silver in the inside.
Yeah. Well, in the trade, I think that it's actually his icon embossed and then it's die cut so that the silver comes through.
Because the only... Honestly, the only Silverhawk I kept was the first trade and the Alan Moore story.
Alan Moore wrote a Shadowhawk story?
Yep. There's a anthology of Shadowhawk like...
Oh, images of Shadowhawk? Alan Moore contributed that?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
There's a Western, Egyptian, and Alan Moore did one. That's when I was big into collecting everything Alan Moore wrote.
Oh, was that like the small prestige format book and it's got like a painted cover?
Yeah.
I didn't know Alan Moore contributed to that.
He wrote
that's
one
cool.
of the stories. I can't remember which one he wrote, but like...
Was it good? Or were you just like, oh, I guess Alan Moore did that?
I read it and I haven't thought about it since, so I'd have to reread it.
Not a good sign, though. Because you weren't as into Alan Moore back then either, right?
No, I was big into Alan Moore, Warren Ellis, Garth Ennis. So any of their weird, like, odd stuff you can't find anymore, I was picking up. And that was just, I mean, I picked up Vigilante because of
the two-parter, Father's Day, I think. Yeah. Jim Bakey, I think, drew that one.
Yeah, just because Alan Moore's name. I own the issues that Alan Moore wrote of Star Wars. He wrote little short stories for Star Wars.
Oh, the magazine?
Mm-hmm. Nah, the comic.
No, but I'm saying that UK had a Star Wars magazine, I think, when they didn't have the US material to reprint.
I don't know.
Yeah, well, so what would happen is since the UKs were weekly, they'd often run out of US material to reprint, and so they'd start making their own. I know that that's what happened with Transformers. That's how Simon Furman ended up becoming so associated with Transformers, is that he was writing the UK version, and they realized, hey, this guy's actually kind of better than the US version. Let's just have him write the US version.
I didn't know that. But yeah, just a little weird shit like that. But yeah, I'll go look for that Shadowhawk stuff. I'm pretty sure I have it in one of my boxes.
So how long was the first Cyberforce miniseries? Was it 3 issues or more? Are you finished with it?
I think it was 4 issues, because I've read the first two and I got the third one, but then I put it down because I had a bunch of stuff come in from the library. So. Okay.
If you finish the miniseries, text me and I'll make a point of reading the first miniseries so that we can talk about it.
Okay. Because right now I'm reading the revival, like a bunch of stuff came in, so it won't be for at least. I'll try to finish it up this weekend, like tomorrow.
Hello and welcome to the Amazing Spider Talk. My name is Dan Gavazdin and I am the editor of SuperiorSpiderTalk.com.
And I'm Mark Giannacchio, the editor of the Chasing Amazing blog.
Thanks for joining us for the Amazing Spider Talk. We hope you enjoy this podcast and that it provides an intelligent conversation between two fans and collectors as we hope to look at the Spider-Man comic universe in a bit of a bigger picture. Of course, you guys can find all of our new Amazing Spider Talk and the old Superior Spider Talk podcasts at SuperiorSpiderTalk.com. Or you can find us on iTunes by searching for Amazing Spider Talk. And if you do, please make sure you leave us a rating and a comment to let us know how we're doing, and we'll read it on the air. If you have any opinions on these comics or any questions, please email them to us at AmazingSpiderTalk@gmail.com, and we'll address and read them on the air.
Yeah, and be sure to check out both our Facebook pages at Facebook.com/SuperiorSpiderTalk and Facebook.com/ChasingAmazing.
Doom Patrol.
1963.
Doom Patrol debut.
My Greatest Adventure, issue 80. 1964.
My Greatest Adventure, renamed Doom Patrol.
Issue 85. 1968.
Doom Patrol destroyed.
Issue 121. 1976.
The new Doom Patrol.
Showcase 94. 1987.
Doom Patrol Volume 2.
Coverberg Lytle. 1989.
Morrison and Case.
Issue 19. 1993.
Pollack.
Issue 64. 2001.
Doom Patrol Volume 3.
Arcudi Hewitt. 2004.
Doom Patrol Volume 4.
Burn.
Shush.
2009.
Doom Patrol Volume 5.
Giffen Clark. 2012. 2013. 2014. 2015. 2016.
Waiting for Doom, the Doom Patrol podcast. Because we're waiting.
Available on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and Podbean.com.
This has been a Roll Spine podcast. Spawn and all related characters and concepts are the copyright of Todd McFarlane. All other characters and concepts are the copyright of their respective parties. We support creators' rights, and we're trying to do y'all a favor by talking about your shit.
Deuce. There's more to it.
apparently there's more to it.
Yeah, hold on. So I'm leaving it alone.
So you have to put this kind of like a disclaimer at the end, so
it helps. To protect it's not a bad idea. We forget sometimes. Mm-hmm. I forget sometimes. But it helps just in case anybody comes sniffing around, especially because we use music and other stuff. So yeah.
Okay. This is a non-for-profit fan-made podcast. These were a bunch of losers in Frank's garage. We do not intend to infringe on anyone's copyright. If you own material we pocketed for this show, congratulations, you're cool now. We figure you're covered under fair use.
We're covered.
Oh, we're covered. Somebody's covered. Yeah.
Go do that one again because we kind of have to be particular about our wording.
We figure we're covered under fair use. So fuck off with any of your butthurt cease and desist bullshit. Por favor. If you're going...
Hold on, let me fix it. It's still jacked. Hold on.
So fuck off with any of your Mac booty shit.
Okay, here we go. Hold on. Okay, there you go.
So fuck off with any of your butthole...
No, you did that one already.
Oh. If you've got something to say, tell it to our email or webpage or feed locations. We may even read them one of these days. If you're in a rush, you can hit us up on Diablo Frank on his Twitter feed. I don't fucking tweet.
Okay, start that one again. Okay.
If you're in a rush, you can hit up Diablo Frank on his Twitter feed. I, Mr. Fix-It, don't tweet. So, yeah, you ain't gonna see me there except for porn. Oh, you asshole. I only use Twitter for porn, and I like my beavers wet and fuzzy. Like in Tino Brass's movies.
That's why I was laughing. When we were driving around and you started saying that, that's why I laughed. Because I was like, I actually scripted that line for you.
You know what I mean?
Because I know how you are with Twitter. So I literally did script that when you said, oh, I only go on Twitter for the porn. It's like, I know. That's why I put it in the script.
Assholes using my own dialogue.
But go ahead and go do it one more time though. Because you were kind of halting.
We may even read them one of these days. If you're in a rush, you can have Diablo Frank on his Twitter feed. I, Mr. Fix-It, don't tweet. I only use Twitter for porn, and I like my beavers wet and fuzzy, like Mr. Tino Brass's movies. So go run and tell Frank, and he can let me know what you say, or whatever, I guess.
Yeah.
That's kind of a dialogue.
Yeah. So go run and tell Frank, and he can let me know what you said, or whatever, I guess.
Yeah.
It's showing you how little you give a shit, because that's kind of your persona.
No, I mean, I kind of like when people, I mean, no one ever tells me anything. I mean, until y'all tell me shit about
the
show.
That's one of the points of the fucking Spawnometer is to give you an opportunity to,
So go run and tell Frank. He can let me know what's going on or whatever, I guess.